I'd like to share with you Psalm 121 as our call to worship this morning. Psalm 121 is the first of 15 psalms that have the heading of Song of Ascents. Many scholars believe that these 15 psalms correspond with the 15 steps the Levites would climb to the inner courtyard of the temple. Each step would have a corresponding song that would be sung in preparation for worship, and so it's appropriate that we would use this psalm as our call to worship this morning. Hear these words. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Please join me in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day, for calling us from our sleep to this time of worship. We thank you, Father God, that you watch over us all the time, that you are always mindful of us, and that you are with us always. During the day, when we can see and things make sense, and even at night, when things are unclear. Lord, we thank you that you promise that you will watch over us and take care of us. And as we turn our attention now to worship you, we pray, Lord, that you would be glorified and that you would be pleased with all that we do and say, and to guide and direct our worship. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things. Amen. Good morning. My name is Darren, and I want to welcome you to our time of worship. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're glad that you're here, and we hope that you'll be blessed by our time together. I also want to invite you to consider joining our community as we give ourselves to helping people discover and follow Jesus. I have just a few announcements to share this morning. First of all, we do plan to kick off our fall programming for both children and youth ministry beginning next Sunday, September 13th. Now, it is going to look a little bit different for our Awana and Sunday school programs, as we'll be offering a virtual learning experience in the form of a video that will be at the end of the worship video next Sunday. So kids, keep your eyes open for a lesson and activity sheet that will be coming in the mail to your house by the end of this week. You can use that activity sheet with the video that will be shown next Sunday. Now, high school and junior high youth groups do plan to meet on site with some restrictions. High school will meet next Sunday, September 13th from 6:30 to 8 o'clock, and junior high will begin meeting next Thursday, the 17th from 6:30 to 8 o'clock. Sunday nights for high school, Thursday nights for junior high, and cadets does plan to begin meeting on September 14th as well. If you're not currently receiving our weekly email updates and you'd like to, please contact the church office at fifthchurch@comcast.net and request to be added to the distribution list. You can also find us on Facebook, and we invite you to visit the church website, fifthchurch@comcast.net, where you can stay up to date with our current phase for safe practices for on-site worship, meetings, and programming. And just a reminder, if you go to fifthchurch.net and scroll all the way to the bottom of the screen, you'll see a tab that says click here to donate now. If you click on that tab, it'll take you to a secure site where you can give of your tithes and your offerings. And of course, you can always use the postal service if you prefer.
My name is Carl Fuller, and I came to this church because it was so friendly after I got here. I stayed here, and we're here for good, I guess. That's all I've got to say, I guess.
Wonderful.
I'm Charlene Fuller, usually say Char Fuller. When we weren't satisfied where we were going, when we would go in there, they might have said good morning, and maybe they didn't. They really didn't care that we were here. And we just had friends that had been going here. And it was right when Pastor Paul started. So we have been coming for almost 10 years, and I think many people probably think we're members. Our prayer, even though we can watch it from our living room, our prayer is that we will soon be well and healthy enough and feel comfortable enough for us all to be together again.
Mm-hmm. Hi, we are the Schofield family. This is Adam, I'm Tracy, this is Brighton, Peyton, and Copeland. Brighton is a senior at Goshen College. Peyton just graduated from Reese Puffer High School. And Copeland is in fifth grade, just started fifth grade yesterday at North Muskegon. We started at Fifth Reform in 2013 when we were looking for a youth group for Brighton to join. And I had attended several of the scrapbook fundraisers the youth group had done in the early 2000s and liked the leadership that was involved and saw in how the kids were taught about Jesus and the Lord. And so that's how we started attending Reform. Our prayer for the church is, Copeland, why don't you come join us, is that the church leadership and members would continue to follow God's word and not man's desire. Be ready to listen to the Holy Spirit always. And how the church body could help us is to continue to pray for us, love us, reach out to us, and have acceptance. We are looking forward to joining. We will not be in person right away due to COVID. But we will trust that we will be with you in worship on Sundays virtually when we get emails, and someday we'll be back together.
Hi, my name is Eileen Land, and I'm happy to be part of the Fifth Reform family. Well, I moved to Muskegon from Grand Rapids a couple of years ago, and I went to church with two families that are here, and they moved from Grand Rapids shortly before I did. So I know Ann and Dan Vanderberg and their kids, and then Diane and Greg McCormick. And Diane and Greg actually were pretty instrumental because they took me to choir with them, first on a Sunday, and then choir rehearsal. So that was fun. Got me involved that way. My prayer for the church is to continue ministering to the congregation, of course, but then also reaching out to the community and spreading God's love and the word of Jesus, and just welcoming more people in to the family. I think the congregation is, and the pastor and all of the staff is just super and very welcoming and warm and kind. It's a good place to be. I do have some back issues, unfortunately, which I take care of by going to the pain clinic every couple of months and getting shots, and I get sedated for that. So Diane McCormick has been taking me to my appointments, because it requires a driver who has to sit there for an hour, hour and a half, and then take me back home, and she's more than willing to do that. She's just an angel about it. But there are times when she's not able to because of her other commitments. So that would be one way, just a driver now and then, very infrequently. And then the other thing is I just appreciate so much being welcomed into the music ministry here at the church. I had been singing in the choir, which is, you know, I can do it, but it's not my forte. I really love playing the piano, and now I'm on the regular schedule, and I'm just so thankful for that. That's such a big part of my life and my worship experience.
Yourself.
I'm Deb McClure.
I'm Bill McClure. My son and daughter-in-law, they belong to Fifth Reform, and they kept telling us how friendly and nice this church is. And we're thinking about it, and we visited them with them, the church, on Easter of 2019, and we found that the people are so friendly, inviting in this congregation that it's just the church that we want to belong and be a part of. This is what we're really looking for. I mean, they're just so friendly. It does too. I mean, you come in, you know, I wasn't used to it neither, you know, just kind of everything where we come from is kind of quiet and, mm-hmm. you know, kind of keep to yourself, and everybody's coming up there and, oh, hey, you know, how you doing? I'm such and such. And even though I can't remember names.
It was something that we've been trying to find through the years. We were without a church for quite a few years. And when this came along, it was, yes, this is
where
it.
We want to be.
Our prayer for the church, for Fifth Reformed Church, is for the continuation and the success of
helping people discover and follow Jesus.
Because
it is a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, because I want to learn. Want to learn a lot.
Yeah.
This is what I need.
Yep.
And I just, you know, just being here where it's just, you know, late, you know, back in life is just so, you just go to church and that was kind of it. But here is just, you know, I love coming to church.
We want to go to church.
Yes.
Yes, we get to go to church.
Well, it's just like, you know, I mean, we're going through the corona, you know, this virus thing. And we only missed one in over at on YouTube.
Oh.
That was it. We made the point every Sunday morning. We're going down the basement and we're going to church, and when we finally got to come back, and it just felt so good to be,
mm-hmm.
you know, I missed the coffee and
fellowship.
Yeah.
You know, the fellowship after, you know, because just seeing people that, you know, you have, you know, just it's just a good feeling.
Yeah. Is there anything that we as your new church body can do to best minister to you guys or to pray for you? Anything specific that you can think of?
I think you have it all covered, in my opinion.
Mine too.
Yeah.
We're just here. We wanna grow in the congregation and strengthen our faith.
How do you capitalize on that? My goodness.
And now let us humbly go before the Lord in the spirit of confession. Please join me in prayer. Father God, there are many ways to be unfaithful to what we have become through baptism, to our commitment and our obedience to you. We offer, Lord, now our prayers of repentance. We confess to you, living God, our failure to live as brothers and sisters and as your children. We confess to you, loving God, that we have not loved you or others as you have loved us. We confess to you, gracious God, that we have doubted your word and failed to obey its teaching. We confess to you, merciful God, our desire to contain you within our own understanding, doctrines, and theologies. We confess to you, almighty God, that we often do not acknowledge you as Lord of all the earth. Forgive us and redeem us, for we have not allowed your presence to shine among us. There are many ways in which we have failed in our commitment and obedience to you and to each other. We turn towards you now and ask your forgiveness and a restoration in our relationship with you, Father. Remember not our disobedience, but may you see us made clean because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the Messiah. It is in his name we ask all these things. Amen. Dear friends, be assured of our forgiveness. Scripture tells us that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He has not punished us as we deserve for all our sins, for his mercy towards those who fear him and honor him is as great as the height of the heavens over the earth.
Good morning, everybody. Pastor Scott here. We are continuing our sermon series of God's Word addressing the reality that many of us face, and that is the reality of fear in many different forms of that fear. If you remember, my friend Rich once, I believe he spoke kind of a discerning word, believing that the spirit of fear has gripped many people's hearts and minds in this season of things right now. And let me just recap that we began this series by remembering the story of Jesus in the boat with the disciples, and the storm suddenly kicks up on the sea, and he asks them, "Why are you afraid?" And that's a very penetrating question for us. And so we've been hearing God speak to us about the fear of being or feeling insignificant in the grand scheme of things in this world. The fear last week we talked about was the fear of disappointing God, which, if you'll recall, that's an accomplished fact. We have disappointed God, but God's posture towards us is one of grace and mercy and love and forgiveness. Today, we're going to talk about fear of life's final moment. And I wanted to remind us of a quote. I'm not a big fan of Woody Allen. I used to be until his life, personal life, became something of a train wreck. But he once said something memorable, and that is that he said it this way: "I'm not afraid to die. I just don't want to be there when it happens." And I wonder if that captures the spirit that some of us may have, maybe we're somewhat unafraid of dying. We just don't want to deal with the actual process of dying. We're not afraid of death. We just don't want to deal with the process of dying. Psalm 23, the whole psalm, which we're going to look at here in a couple minutes, actually speaks of the reality, the valley of the shadow of death that often gets translated. And I want you to know that I'm not in my office this morning. I'm in the sanctuary. I'm preaching to an empty room, at least empty of people, besides myself. And I'm standing in a particular spot. I'm going to step away from the camera a minute, but here's the podium, and the stained glass is behind me. I have pushed the communion table aside, and I'm standing in that particular location because I think that for many of us, This particular piece of real estate, this piece of square footage in our building, could be regarded as our, for Fifth Reformed Church, our valley of the shadow of death. And why do I say that? Earlier in this week, we did a funeral service for one of our members. Several weeks before that, we did another funeral service. And for each one, and for virtually every funeral service that we've done here since my time, and I'm sure for many decades before, this particular location is where the remains, the casket, the cremains, whatever is involved in that service, that's where those things are during the funeral service. And so I think that this is a particular piece of square footage in our building that we could regard as the Valley of the Shadow of Death. Because many of us, if we're still connected to this ministry by the time our time comes, we're going to end up right here. And many of us are able to anticipate dealing with the Valley of the Shadow of Death. So let me say a few words about the Valley of Death. The Valley of Death is unavoidable. None of us will be spared, unless Jesus returns first, none of us will be spared the reality of death. Hebrews 9:27 says, people are destined to die once, and after that, to face judgment. This is a blanket statement that applies to each one of us. Every one of us will experience the reality of the physical death of our bodies. The valley of death is unpredictable. Book of James says it this way about all of life's circumstances, including death. Now listen, he says, you who say today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money, why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. And the sense of what James is saying is there is that the reality of our physical death is unpredictable. None of us knows for sure when and how that's going to happen. We can also say that the valley of death is impartial. Romans 2, 11 reminds us, for God does not show favoritism. And the particular argument that Paul is making there is that because we're all sinners, Jews and Gentiles alike, God does not show favoritism to one group over the other. And the reality is that when you link these verses together, Romans 6:23 that we talked about last week, the wages of sin is death. So if we are sinners, Jews, Gentiles, everybody, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, the wages of that sin is death, and that applies to all of us. That doesn't apply to only this group of people and not that group of people. It applies to all of us. The valley of death is impartial. So the bad news, remember last week I talked about the gospel being bad news before it's good news? The bad news is that every one of us is going to face the physical death of our bodies unless Jesus returns first. So that's the bad news. But there is good news that the Word of God wants us to hear and receive this morning as we confront that reality that every one of us is going to have a physical body that dies. And so now we turn to the rest of Psalm 23, more than just verse 4 that speaks about the valley of the shadow of death. But look at the rest of it. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I want to zero in on the words that surround this phrase about the darkest valley, the valley of the shadow of death. Listen to verse 4 again. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And I really want to zero in on those red letters right there. For you are with me. God has promised again and again in his word never to depart from us, never to ignore us or leave us. Never will I leave nor forsake you, he has said. And so this is another iteration of that promise. The psalmist says, David says, you are with me. God's presence is with him, with us, even as we confront the reality of our walking through the darkest valley, the valley of the shadow of death. And as we look at the rest of the scriptures, it is helpful then to see that Jesus is the fulfillment of that very promise, that very presence of God with us. Remember when Jesus says in John 10, speaking again of the good shepherd that's referenced in Psalm 23. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. The presence that is promised to us, for you are with me, it says in Psalm 23, verse 4, is given to us in the person, in the presence of Jesus Christ. He is the fulfillment of that sense of God being with us, even as we deal with the reality of death. Remember the story, the death of Lazarus. Jesus stays away until Lazarus is 4 days dead. And then he returns, and Mary and Martha kind of confront him as he's coming to the grave where Lazarus is buried. And there's kind of an accusation, Jesus, if you had been here, this would not have happened to Lazarus. And Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. This promise of Psalm 23, verse 4, for you are with me, even as I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, is fulfilled in Jesus Christ when he says, I am the resurrection. When you believe in me, even though you die, even though you walk through that valley of the shadow of death, when you believe in me, you will never die. That promise that is referenced in Psalm 23, verse 4, finds its fulfillment in the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. He came to be with us. He came to walk with us through the valley of the shadow of death so that we can get to the other side. And it's that same sense of conviction that life in Christ is bigger than anything that this world can throw at us that leads the Apostle Paul, again, to speak about some of these very same themes. Paul says it this way, and if I must tell you editorially that if I have a life verse in the scriptures, one that just I grab a hold of and has been perhaps maybe more impactful and more important to me than maybe almost any other verse, this is it for me. Philippians 1, verses 20 and 21. Paul says it this way, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. To live is Christ. To live is to stay here in this world and to be about our Father's business, to be on mission with Jesus. To live is Christ. But when our assignment is done, we can look forward to the gain part of that equation. And we're going to spend a little time this morning articulating what does it mean that we gain when we die. First of all, I believe that what Paul is referencing here is that we can gain a life free of pain and trouble. In fact, we live with this very promise given to us in Revelation 21, where the Apostle John is given a vision of what will be in the future. And God says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. I just want to pause in this moment and wonder if there's anybody who can hear my voice this morning who's dealing with chronic pain, a chronic sense of either spiritual, emotional pain, a sense of loss, or maybe you're living with a body that doesn't work like it used to, and it's complicating and frustrating your life. When we look forward to what we will gain when our time here is done, and we look forward to going to be with Jesus, that will go away. That old order of things will pass away. We gain a life free of pain and trouble. Secondly, we gain an eternal life. Jesus references this again in John 3:16, which I referenced recently in my preaching. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Have you ever been on a vacation, and as the week or 2 weeks or whatever the time is kind of winding down? For us, the summer is winding down, and maybe there's a sense of, oh no, this season is going to come to an end. But the eternal life, the life that we gain when we leave this world to go be in the Lord's house, it's not like a limited vacation that has a beginning and an end. It's an eternal life that we get to look forward to. Thirdly, we gain a glorious home. I love these words from John 14. I preach these words almost every funeral that I do. In fact, I often will ask the family for permission to read these words from John 14. He said to his disciples, look, I'm not going to be with you here in this earthly bodily form. I'm going to be leaving you, and they're troubled. And so Jesus speaks to them, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? Talk about a serious upgrade in our accommodations. We are living here on planet Earth, but when our time is done, when Jesus takes us home to be in the Father's house, we get to be a part. We get to live in God's mansion. And I just want you to dwell on this for a moment. There is a room in God's mansion with your name on it. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you belong to him and he belongs to you, if you are in Christ and he is in you, you have a room in God's mansion with your name on it. And it is a part of a glorious home that we can look forward to. And lastly, when we gain, we gain perfection, right? Listen to how 1 John describes it. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Christ is in his glorious resurrected form in heaven, and when we go to be with him, it says we shall become like him. And I don't know about you, but when I'm aware of my imperfections, both in my body and in my spirit, and the things that I struggle with, and the troubles that I have, it is a great encouragement to me and to you to know that all of that will go away. We will gain perfection. We will live fully as the persons that God created and called us to be. While it's a struggle here because we stumble and fall, when we get to go be with our Father, we will gain perfection. So let's be clear about this. And I'm saying this, remember, I'm standing in the valley of the shadow of death at Fifth Reformed Church, right here. Because of Jesus, we can say, I can be relieved that this world is not my home. This is not the final destination. Last week, I told you a French phrase, fait accompli. Today, here's a German one, Weltschmerz. You might not know that word. It's a sense of sadness and melancholy and weariness that the world is kind of messed up. It's not kind of messed up. It's very messed up. And if we have this sense that this is all there is, that can make us very sad, and we can get weary of having to navigate through some of the world's trouble. There's a German phrase. That's what Weltschmerz is, to have that kind of sadness and that sense of weariness. But because of Jesus, our Weltschmerz loses. I can be relieved that this world is not my home, that I'm here for a time, but I'm looking forward to something better, something glorious. Because of Jesus, I can hold loosely to this life. And so we may have possessions and relationships, even our own physical bodies. We don't need to grasp and to claw and to clutch all of the world's material possessions to ourselves, even our own physical life. We can hold loosely to this because we know that our time here is only a temporary assignment. We know that there is a glorious life of gain that awaits us as we walk through the doorway of death. Because of Jesus, I need not fear the hospice bed or the hospital bed. This is a painful reality that many families, many marriages have to deal with. When somebody gets sick and their life is in its final weeks or months or days, even final moments, there's a sense of dread that comes with that, sort of like what Woody Allen was saying. I just don't want to be there when it happens. And friends, I think that we need not fear the hospice bed. Hospice does a wonderful job of helping people navigate through end of life, making people feel comfortable, creating space for families to gather around those who are in the process of departing this world. And we need not fear this because this is not the end. The glorious future of gain that we look to forward to helps us to think differently about the process of dying. I want to challenge, especially those of you who are married, to have conversations around this and end-of-life issues, and to say, be able to say with one another, we don't need to do drastic measures when it's clear that the end is imminent. I was just dealing with a family recently where one of the spouses was being kept alive by medical equipment long past the time when they otherwise would have departed. And that was a painful thing for them to deal with. And because of Jesus, friends, we can navigate better, more hopefully, through those kinds of difficult situations. Because of Jesus, I can look beyond the doorway of death with joyful anticipation. If you've spent any time in the Word imagining what awaits us in the next life, I just want to encourage you to spend some time this afternoon or in the week ahead, imagining that when your time comes, when your assignment is finished, and you walk through the doorway of death, what that will be like. I don't think any of us knows exactly what it will be like, but we can imagine. I think the Word of God can shape our imagination for what it will be like. The words that occur to me are Jesus' words to the thief on the cross when he says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." What will it be like? Not what would it be like, but what will it be like when those words get spoken to us and we come into the presence of Christ? Because of Jesus, I can look beyond the doorway of death with a sense of joyful anticipation, and to be able to see Jesus face to face, it's a wonderful sense of hope and anticipation. And because of Jesus, then, I need not fear the grave. I think that over the course of my ministry, I don't know how many dozens of times that I've done funerals where it was not clear if the person was a believer and trusted Jesus, and the family is just very troubled, not sure what to think about the passing of their loved one. But when the loved one is a believer in Jesus and they don't fear the grave and the rest of the family shares that faith, friends, there is a wonderful sense of relief that can come into the equation in the passing. Yes, it's sad. We love the person. They're gone. But what a different story to anticipate that they've gone to be with Jesus, that they've checked into their room in God's glorious mansion. And this grave that we have to deal with here in this life, this is not something that needs to give us fear, not at all. Remember, Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life." But at the end of that opening foray in that conversation with Martha, Jesus ends up saying to her, "Do you believe this?" And I think the Word of God is wanting to prompt us with that very question. And in fact, I want to encourage you to be asking yourself this question: do I believe that there is life beyond the grave, that there is gain that happens when my assignment here is done and when I get to go and be with Jesus? Do I truly believe this, or is this just some sort of information that I've not really wrapped my heart and my mind around? Jesus wants to ask that penetrating question. He says, "I am the resurrection and the life." It's not that I know about the resurrection or can point you to it. He says, "I am the resurrection and the life. Do you believe this?" I want to encourage you with the spiritual practice of taking some words of scripture or some words of well-known hymns and to pray them. Have this be your prayer. And an example of that would be with the hymn, "Because He Lives," which, by the way, is going to be the postlude today after the benediction. If you want to enjoy that music, stick around throughout the rest of the postlude after the benediction today. But let's pray these words. And if you want to say these things out loud with me, I encourage you or invite you to do that. "Dear God, I believe that because Jesus lives, I can face tomorrow. Dear God, I believe that because Jesus lives, all my fear is gone. Dear God, I believe that because Jesus holds the future, my life is worth the living just because He lives." Friends, when I engage in this kind of spiritual practice of praying the scriptures and saying out loud that I believe what the word says or what the words of the hymn says, I think the Spirit of God comes alongside me and says, "Scott, do you really believe that? Or are you just mouthing some words?" I want to challenge you to have some time, some quiet time with the Lord, and to have the Spirit, invite the Spirit to sort of poke and prod you with that question: do you really believe what the Word says? Do you really believe this witness, this testimony of this hymn, "Because He Lives"? The Valley of the Shadow of Death. There's some artwork out there that gives sort of a depiction of what that could be like. This one, to me, is very dark. Somebody walking off into what looks like a tunnel, and there's the figure above of somebody that looks like they're sad or depressed or deflated. I think that for many people, as they anticipate or consider their own personal walk through the valley of the shadow of death, it may evoke images and feelings that would be consistent with this picture. Another picture that I found, this is better. Somebody is walking across what looks like a bridge, and there's a light at the end of the tunnel, but it really is still kind of generic. It's hopeful, but it's generic in its hopefulness. The picture that I'm most drawn to about the valley of the shadow of death, the one that I'm standing in, by the way, and if you're connected to the future and your time on planet Earth is done and we end up in this place and your body is here, wouldn't you want your imagery for walking through the valley of the shadow of death to look like this? It's focused on Christ. There is a light at the end of the tunnel, and the light is Jesus Christ himself. Friends, this is the word of God. Let's pray together. God, we pray that this morning we might be comforted and encouraged and made hopeful by the word of God, by the promise from Psalm 23 that you are with us when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. God, we are hopeful because of Jesus, because he is the resurrection and the life, that we will gain when our time here is done, as it will be done for every last one of us. So God, give us that sense of joyful anticipation. Help us to hold loosely to the things of this earth. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, the light at the end of the tunnel, the author and finisher of our faith. Help us to grow in faith in him. For it is in Christ alone that we find our hope in this life and our hope for the life to come. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we now prepare to turn our hearts to God in the spirit of prayer, I want to just give you a little bit of an urging. You'll recall that earlier in the service, we recognized that we have some new members who are inbound, who are part of our fellowship, and we're publicly going to receive and recognize them and even have some baptisms that are going to happen next Sunday morning, September 13. I wonder, for those of you who haven't yet come to on-site worship, we don't want to urge anybody before they are ready, but I do want to encourage you to at least consider and pray about coming next week. I think it will be a wonderful service to be able to extend the elbow of fellowship to those who have most recently become a part of our ministry. And so please pray about that. Again, I don't want to challenge anybody to do something that they're not yet ready to do, but please just weigh that and make a choice for yourself. But I want to urge you to come if you are at all open to that. Let's come to God in the spirit of prayer. God, you are loving and faithful. You are righteous and true. Truly, there is none other like you in all of creation. You are the creator, the maker of everything that is. What's more, you are the promise-making, promise-keeping God. Your word bears witness repeatedly that you are faithful to us, your people. And you have told us, never will I leave you nor forsake you. Not only so, you are our Redeemer, saving us from our sins, saving us from our self-destructive ways, saving us from the eternal consequences of going our own way instead of seeking your path. Father, we have sinned. We have ignored you. We have not followed through with what we know to be true and right. We have lived indulgently when our focus should have been about keeping our eyes on Jesus and listening for his voice. Have mercy on us and forgive us the guilt of our sin. Lord God, on this Labor Day weekend, we thank you for the freedoms we enjoy in this country, the freedoms to work, to use our skills and talents, to provide for our families. We thank you for our health and our strength. We thank you for our bodies. We thank you for the very air that we breathe. All that we have comes from your gracious hand of providence, including the opportunity to work. And so we recognize you right now as the giver of every good gift and pray your blessing on our labor, on our work. Father, we humbly ask you to provide for our every need. While our nation is tearing apart at the seams, bring peace and truth. Raise up Christ followers who are willing and able to show that there is a better way to live. As we interact with a watching world, may they experience the love of Christ through our words and our deeds. While our families struggle to navigate through the changing realities of opening school in the midst of a pandemic, while our economy falters, help us to remain calm and focused. Spirit of God, bring forth in us words of encouragement rather than words that cut and destroy. Lord, we need you now more than ever. Father, in this year of electoral politics and 24/7 news, and now campaign ads, give us the ability to think clearly, to listen with discernment, to distinguish truth from lies, and to be faithful according to your leading in our lives and in our country. Father, we pray your blessing on those in our church family who are struggling with illness and disease and aging bodies that don't work like they used to. We pray your blessing on those who are anticipating surgery in the days ahead. We pray for peace for those who struggle with depression. And we pray for your presence for those who live with the burden of loneliness. God, we look to you for our every need, trusting that you will be faithful in each and every season of life, including our final moment, whenever that will come. All these things we pray in Jesus' name, the one who lived for us, who died for us, who rose again from the grave for us, and who now intercedes for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now to him who is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work in us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus our Lord, to the glory of God the Father forever and ever. Amen.